Francesca. Francesca Chambers is the editor of Red Alert Politics. Red Alert is an online publication that is written for, written by and for young conservatives. It's a product of Clarity Media Group, which is the parent company of the Washington Examiner and Weekly Standard. Francesca is a veteran of several political campaigns and also has worked in new media communications at Leadership Institute, the Republican National Committee, and also on Capitol Hill. She graduated from University of Kansas with BAs in political science and journalism. At KU, she was editor of the University Daily Kansan and an active member of Student Senate. So we're very happy to have Francesca here. Please welcome.
First, I'm here to say the Tea Party is definitely not racist. People are often surprised to find when they're on Twitter or whatnot, they're getting arguments with me, and they're saying, well, you're, you know, it's just because the Tea Party's racist. I'm like, have you seen a picture of me? It's not because the Tea Party's racist. So I want to talk a little bit first to explain kind of what Red Alert Politics is, because I'm sure most of you don't know. It's newer. We've only been around for 6 months as of last week or next week. It is owned by Clarity Media Group, which owns the Weekly Standard and the Washington Examiner. And we were created because there's not a lot of other publications out there that are center-right that really speak to young people. Our company was really concerned about getting more young activists, getting the next generation involved, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with other publications, you know, targeting folks who are not in the 20 to 30 range. We need news for them too, but we really needed something to speak to young people, because all they're doing is they're getting their news from Jon Stewart. And we need something that was actually based in fact. And that's not where you're going to get on a show. And I love watching a show, don't get me wrong, but it's not based in fact a lot of times. They purposefully edit things to be funny, not to be true. And so we started Red Alert Politics. It launched at CPAC in February. And so I'm editor of that. And when we talk about media bias, you know, to me it's sort of a no-brainer at this point. Like, of course the media is biased, you know. The reason that all three of these publications were created was for that reason. My company, which owns, you know, the Washington Examiner, the Examiner is the conservative alternative to the Washington Post. And that was created about 6 years ago before, you know, the Daily Caller and some of these others existed. And honestly, if it wasn't for the Washington Post being so liberal, there wouldn't be a market for the Washington Examiner, which I also write for. And so that to me just really says that's how liberal the Post is, and everyone knows it, in that, you know, there's a whole other publication that exists to be, you know, on the other side of the Post. And talking about some of the other bias things, you know, we talked about, is there a problem with being biased? No, I don't necessarily, I agree, I don't necessarily see a problem with reporters being biased and opinions being biased, as long as you say that they are. Even on the opinion page, I think it's important to point out your biases, because, you know, the New York Times, for example, you know, the opinion page isn't supposed to be all liberal, right? There should be some editorials that are straight down the middle, or, you know, give Republicans some credit sometimes. And I haven't seen anything that gives Republicans or the Tea Party conservatives any credit on the New York Times editorial page in years. You know, it's been a very long time. And so, and that's a problem, even though it's the editorial page, when we're talking about a major national newspaper where most people get their news and opinions from. Which brings me back to, you know, the Washington Post. I think that's another really good example of this year, how they've especially showed their bias. I'm sure everyone's familiar with their hate piece on Mitt Romney and about how he teased the gay kid, and the gay kid who isn't even alive anymore. So they can't actually check that story with the actual source. And then within, you know, 24 hours, it was a situation like the Rubio situation, where it's just thing after thing that they had to correct because people who were involved kept coming out and saying, like, well, that's not what I said, and I wasn't actually there when it took place, the supposed incident, and whatnot. And I mean, there was really no excuse for that shoddy of reporting from the Washington Post. And that's an example. You know, the New York Times, too, this year, it was unbelievable to me. I don't know if anyone else read about this, but when they went to Mitt Romney's house in LA, and they were stalking his house and talking to his neighbors, I mean, that's unbelievable. When did they do that to John Kerry? When were they going up to any of these liberals, you know, homes, large mansions, and talking to their neighbors about that kind of stuff? They wouldn't do that. And yet you see that happening with Mitt Romney, who's a Republican. And so I think that it's just very obvious to me anymore. I don't see how anyone else could say, like, oh, well, they're not biased. Of course they're biased, you know? How can you call that not biased? And I think a lot of people just don't realize sometimes that these major publications are so biased, because if you're not at an event or you're not very familiar with it, you wouldn't know that something was biased reporting. For instance, you know, I still grew up in the age, even though I'm a lot, you know, I'm younger, when I still thought the world of the Washington Post. Okay, I wanted to work at the Washington Post when I grew up. That's why I wanted to move to D.C. You know, that was my dream. And it wasn't until I actually started working in journalism in a big way and actually getting to go to a lot of the major events like the Republican National Convention, the Democrat National Convention, and some of these other things, and seeing how they were covered from some of these big publications when I was already at the event too, and would say, that's not exactly how that happened. And if you weren't at the event, how would you know that that's not how it didn't happen, especially if there's not center-right media there, you know, to get the word out too. And so I literally, and I think most other people, just have no idea that a lot of times these events are being reported on in a biased manner. And they really, really are. Once I actually started covering those events and working in conservative media, I definitely saw a lot more bias in the media than I had when I first started doing this. A lot of times I would think, you know, oh, it's just overhyped and overblown, you know, they're just upset because they didn't agree with the article. But I don't think that anymore. I definitely think now that the media is super biased. And again, it's not just how you report things. I think a whole other side of it is what you're reporting on that makes you biased, because you ignore one thing if you're a journalist who leans to the left and write on something else instead because you want to attack conservatives or Republicans. And there's two really recent examples from the last 2 weeks that I can point to on that that really shows you a bias if you're not sure if something's biased. I saw The Atlantic did an article yesterday on why Mitt Romney hadn't been to Chick-fil-A yet. And I was like, Mitt Romney just got back from an overseas trip. Like, when did you want him to go to Chick-fil-A? Did you want him to take the plane and demand that they land in a Chick-fil-A parking lot so he could get his Chick-fil-A, you know, end the overseas trip early so that he could go support Chick-fil-A? That was just the most outrageous thing I read. Well, clearly, it was because he was in Poland. He just got back, okay? And they're like, why hasn't he been to Chick-fil-A yet? You know, he clearly doesn't support this. He's not as conservative as he says that he is, because he didn't go to Chick-fil-A yet. And I just could not believe that that was actually something that they wasted their time on, you know? And another one about how you report things is, and what you report, is the George Stephanopoulos thing. I think more people are familiar with Brian Ross in the situation, but I don't want George Stephanopoulos to get left out of the story, because to me, the George Stephanopoulos thing is way more important than what Brian Ross did. So during the Colorado Theater Massacre, the morning after, you know, leave it to George Stephanopoulos and ABC to say, we've got some breaking news. This could be substantial. We think that this James guy could be part of the Colorado Tea Party. And they report this. And then, of course, Bill McMorris over the Washington Free Beacon. If you guys aren't familiar with the Free Beacon yet, you should definitely read that. I love that publication, too. He tweets and says, oh, yeah, because there's not, like, hundreds of, you know, James or Holmes or Jim's Holmes, you know, in the Colorado Aurora area. And he links to the White Pages website. And you just see that there's pages and pages of someone named Jim or James Holmes from the same exact area. We're not talking about the greater area, the same city. And you can see that it could have been any one of those people who were in the Tea Party. How do you know that it was this guy? And of course then, you know, Politico reports on, you know, how they made this false claim. And I was actually really surprised that Politico kept up on that. And they kept hammering them for that, which was fantastic. You know, and of course, by the middle of the day, ABC then apologizes. But they didn't come out and apologize. Yeah. They buried it in another article about the shooting that, oh, it turns out that this guy isn't involved with the Tea Party. It's like, oh, you think, you know? And that's, they didn't even apologize, actually. It was buried in another article. And that's just shameful. And the reason I say that George Stephanopoulos is sort of like the key part of this for me is because, so George Stephanopoulos says to Brian Ross, you know, oh, I hear you have something substantial that could be a game changer, whatever. He knew what it was that Brian Ross had and gave him the thumbs up and said, you know, let's, you know, bring out the Tea Party into this. And so then Brian Ross does his report, and Brian Ross is obviously in the wrong, but George Stephanopoulos was like, come on, let's bring it on. He was just excited to have an opportunity to bash the Tea Party. And, you know, I wouldn't expect any less from a guy who used to be the White House press secretary in a Democratic administration, you know? And I hate to say that, but it's the truth. And it's really funny. I always say that, you know, if I try to get a job at ABC after working for Clarity Media Group, which is openly center-right, they'd probably laugh me out of the room. They would be like, absolutely not, you're biased. We're not going to put you in a job. You tell me you're going to be unbiased, but I don't trust you. Oh, but you trust George Stephanopoulos, you know? He was the White House press secretary. He was literally the mouthpiece of the, you know, the Clinton administration. But he gets a job at ABC, not just at ABC. He does the morning show now. He does the show, you know, at the top of the weekend for the Sunday morning shows. And so that's a really clear example of, you can say you're not biased all day long, but that's, I mean, you're telling me that all of a sudden now you're not biased toward Democrats, you have a revelation? I don't believe that.
You never really know how she feels. Yeah.
How can we help people educate themselves on understanding bias? People in my Tea Party are my age and older, not necessarily as connected into Twitter as you all are, but susceptible to the media bias that we have to deal with every day. So that's the question. Please educate us.
To be very specific, if someone wanted to know the difference, I'm going to use voter ID as an example of how you can know if there be any bias. Now, what we would say when we're pushing, you know, why do we need voter ID laws? Because we're trying to protect voters. It's voter protection. We would also say, you know, we're trying to curb voter fraud, right? But when you hear the left, they're going to say we're trying to disenfranchise minorities and seniors. We're also trying to suppress the vote, right? So there are definitely specific words.
And another good book on this is also 1984. Yeah. Just skip the Jonah Goldberg book. Happens that, you know, that Karl Rove, you know, gets his own show on, or and gets to pretend that he could host a Sunday morning show and pretend that he's completely not biased. That never happens.
You know, there's a reason Dana Perino's on Fox, right? She's fantastic. I think she should definitely be on some of the Sunday morning shows, but yet she gets, you know, she's on Fox, so she's not on ABC. I'd much rather have her on ABC.
All right, what else?
But the mainstream media was going off about, you know, how the conservative blogosphere is having a love affair with this particular conservative candidate. No, it's not that I particularly like this conservative candidate versus other conservative candidates, or that anyone else does. It's that this candidate makes himself, herself available to conservative bloggers. So even if you make yourself available and you say, hey, do you want to schedule a call, then we'll totally write about you, but you have to make yourself available. And so I think that's a very good point, that it would be more helpful if the members would make themselves available. But also what you said about knocking on doors, or you said talking about to your neighbors, but knocking on doors is really, really important as someone who's worked a lot political campaigns. I don't necessarily mean you have to go door to door for like a specific candidate. You know, you can go for a cause. AFP, I know, does a lot of grassroots stuff, because you'd be surprised at how many neighbors just don't realize that there's other people in their community who feel that way or know anybody else who's involved in politics, and then they'll say, oh great, how can I get more information, how can I get involved? No one's just ever reached out to them and they don't know how to get involved, and so it's very important that you do that kind of grassroots type stuff.
Right. Yes, sir.
Thanks.